the Father? Why is it the promise of the Father and not just the promise of Jesus or the promise of the Holy Ghost? You know, a lot of times in the church we miss the fact that the ministry, the work of Jesus, was to reconcile us to the Father.
That's right.
That's his work.
Yes, amen. That's good.
You know, and some of us, we are supposed to worship Jesus. We are supposed to love, adore, and worship him. He is our Savior. He is our Lord. But we're not supposed to stop there.
That's right.
We are supposed to allow him to take us to the Father.
That's right.
We are supposed to allow him to take us. You know, the word says that through the Holy Spirit that we have access. I think that's Ephesians 2:38. We have been given access to the Father. Christ did that. Jesus did that for us. That was his ministry. His ministry was to get the sin out of the way so that we could have access to God the Father again. That's why he humbled himself and came and did the work. We're not supposed to be just earthbound.
Right.
We are supposed to be seeking relationship with the Father. That is why Jesus keeps telling them, this is the promise of the Father, the promise of the Father, the promise of the Father. Guess what? Jesus is the bridge to the Father. Guess what? The Father wants to come across the bridge to you too. It's not all about us just going to the Father. The Father wants to come across to you too. Well, how does he do that? He does that because Jesus gets the sin out of the way. He sends the Spirit. He sends the Spirit. His Spirit comes across the bridge. After Jesus takes care of the sin problem, the Spirit comes across the bridge. That's how you get baptized. That's how you get filled. All of a sudden, there's this relationship going on back and forth. You know what? Prayer is not supposed to be just about you talking to him. Prayer is supposed to be about him talking to you too. Two-way conversation, back and forth, back and forth. This is relationship. You know, husband and wife, it's not supposed to be just one of you talking. It's supposed to be communication both ways, right?
Right.
This is what Jesus was doing. He was getting the sin problem out of the way so that we could have this relationship with Father. And so he calls it the promise of the Father. So the promise of the Father is Jesus gets the sin out of the way. The Father sends the Spirit. All of a sudden, now we got relationship going both ways. Now all of a sudden, not only does my Spirit dwell in you because you're saved, but now all of a sudden my Spirit's all over you. My Spirit's empowering you. My gifts are working in you. And people see you and say, wow, they look like little Jesus. They look like God's children. That's the whole thing. When the Spirit gets on you, you get soaked in the Holy Spirit. You start acting less like the flesh, less like your natural parents, and more like your heavenly Father. They start saying, that's a child of God. If that person looks, he's got the nature. They act like God. Then all of a sudden you're operating in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And people are doing like they did with Peter. They're like, this is not a normal everyday occurrence. They start realizing God is present. God is real. That's how we get opportunity to testify and be world changers. Okay, Acts 11:13. So why is Jesus keep calling it promise of the Father? Luke, you're right. Luke 11:13. Jesus is trying to help us get our minds to comprehend this whole deal, this whole plan. Everything he's done here on the earth is about getting you to the Father.
Right.
It's the promise of the Father. Is that Jesus says, I've done my job, now the Father is going to start his part. And that the part is, you're saved now because I've taken care of your sin issue. Now the Father wants to release the power of the Spirit in your life so that you can have this intimate relationship with him. So let's see here. So Jesus is trying to get them to comprehend God in the terms of Father and child. Father and child. So that we can start realizing I can have a relationship with this amazing God being. 13 says, and this is read, so it's Jesus teaching them about who God is. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask.
There it is.
Now listen. So we've been talking, you see it in your scripture. And people say, well, I don't know. I love God and I believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I've seen people in the church get baptized in the Holy Spirit. Yeah, I want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Okay, Jesus says ask. There's a step to it. Did you have to ask to be saved? Or yes. Did you just sit in your pew and it happened magically? No, you had to ask, didn't you? You know, either the preacher had an altar call and you responded and you came and you asked. Or you did it at home, but you asked God. You said, God, I'm sorry for my sins. Please. Oh, please. That's a good start when you're asking. Please. Please save me. Same thing with being baptized with the Holy Spirit. Please, Lord, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I need your power to be the kind of child, daughter, or son of God that you want me to be. Jesus instructs them right here in 13. How much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? This is how you get your salvation. This is how you get your baptism with the Holy Spirit. This is how you get your healing. This is how you get most of everything from God the Father, is you got to ask. You believe that He's good. You believe that He loves you. You do need to repent. Remember Peter preached, repent? Whatever's wrong, get it out of your life. Ask God to forgive you of it. Guess what? Being baptized with the Holy Spirit will help you a lot with the sin issue. Him being filled with the Holy Spirit, baptized with the Holy Spirit, will help you a lot to not get into sin and will help you to get out of sin quicker. You need Him. But Jesus gives them instruction. God the Father is good and He wants to give you good gifts. You know what? Being baptized with the Holy Spirit is a good gift. Just like your salvation was a good gift. When we went to Nicaragua and we ministered down there, I was just so amazed at how easily, when we preached, how easily people, when I preached and we prayed for them, how easily they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Because you know what? In their culture, they believe their Father is good. So when you tell them your Father has a good gift for you, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, they absolutely, it's easy for them. Because they believe daddies are good, and they believe daddies give good gifts. And so when you tell them the Father has promised and He has a good gift of the Holy Spirit for you, didn't they? They came up, we prayed for them. We had over 100, I think, easily baptized, filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. Easily. Because you know what? They haven't been taught all that stuff about it's not real or so hard to get it, you know. You have to pray, pray, and pray and seek and seek and seek. No. All they had to do was hear these scriptures and ask God and they got it. Let me ask you something. Does this scripture say A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you do these things and then ask God?
Nope.
No. It basically says, believe your heavenly Father is good. And He has this gift to give you. And ask. Three things. Believe He's good. He has a gift for you. And ask. You have to ask in faith. I want to encourage folks. And also, let's say it's been years since you were baptized in the Holy Spirit. And it's been years. Maybe you weren't taught. So, you know what? Some people were never taught that once you're baptized with the Holy Spirit, that you should daily use your prayer language, that it is now yours to pray in. It's part of your equipment. It's part of the gifts you've been given. And it's not, I have to wait till I'm in a powerful church service and I feel the power of the Holy Spirit. But it's something that you should exercise daily. Some people haven't been taught that, so they haven't prayed in their prayer language for years and years. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with coming back. You know, the Bible talks about go back and do your first works. There's nothing wrong with coming back again and saying, coming up to the altar and saying, would you pray for me? I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, but I need a fresh touch, and I want my prayer language to be fluid again. There's nothing wrong with having people pray with you again to have that fresh anointing come back on you. So I want to look at Acts 10. I've got two more verses, and I just want to leave this with you before we pray. Because I want you to understand, it is a good gift, but don't think of it as an optional gift. It's a necessary gift. It's
yes.
a greatly needed gift. And it goes, Acts 10, 40, 45. Let's go to 30 first. Acts 10, 30. Acts 10, 30 says, I'm sorry, it's actually 38. Can't read my own writing. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. The scripture actually tells us that God the Father anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and with power. And then he went about doing mighty works. Now, most of us as mainstream Christians at least should agree that Christ Jesus is the perfect example of how we should believe, how we should operate as Christians.
Yes.
We shouldn't have any dispute about if Jesus did it, it should be a perfect example unto us. The scripture tells us that Jesus was anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. And that's how he operated his ministry. If you are a believer and you believe Jesus is your perfect example, if he did it that way, you should do it that way too. One more scripture. And let's drop down to 45. This is Acts 10:45. And I hope that folks, I hope you will listen to this again. Pause it. Pull your Bible out. Follow along. I think it's powerful when you read it for yourself. Open your Bible. Read those scriptures out loud to yourself. So it's not just some woman preaching to you. But you see for yourself in your Bible that God left those words for you. And that Acts 10:45 says, and those of the circumcision who believed were astonished, as many who came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. All right, now, for those of you who want to argue that it was only the 120 who got baptized in the room, only the initial disciples of Christ, that's not right. Scripture has just said it's not right. Because we know about Cornelius. And we know Scripture says right now that Scripture says it, that it also calls the Holy Spirit a gift. That the gift of the Holy Spirit, there again, the gift, the promise of the Father, the gift of the Holy Spirit, had been poured out on the Gentiles also. We know that the 120 in the upper room were Jews. So we already know. And remember when Peter preached, he preached and he said that this is unto you and your children and to those who are afar off, those that have been called. So this is not an ever-ending thing. Those who are far off and who have been called. In other words, this is going to be continuing until the church, until the work of the earth is done. I'm so glad we get to participate just because we are born in latter generations. Doesn't mean we have to lose out.
Right.
It doesn't mean that we miss out on the promise of the Father or the ministry of the Holy Spirit. All right. I would like, if you would, to join me. Let's pray. I want to pray because I know some of you have heard this and faith has rose up. And you know, when faith is there, that's the time. That's the time to seek God when your faith is there, when it's high. So I want us to join and let's pray. Let's pray for folks. Father, we come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are grateful for your word.
Yes.
We are thankful for your word that guides us, that corrects us, and leads us. And we are thankful for the ministry of your Holy Spirit that helps us to understand your word. So we come to you right now, and Lord, we just believe and we ask. You know, you instructed us, Lord Jesus, to ask the Father. So, Father, we ask you that you would please baptize us in your Holy Spirit, that you would save us, that you would fill us with the Holy Spirit, that you would pour out on us, and that you would give us the power that we need to be your people, your sons, your daughters in the earth, and that we would walk in the ministry that you had have given each of us. We pray, Lord, that you would fill us with the Holy Spirit, that it would be something that is manifest, that people would see, that they would hear it. And we pray for our prayer language, Lord, to worship you in perfection, to praise you in perfection, and to pray with perfection, Lord. And so we give you glory now, Lord, as we worship you for this word and for this work. And we give you glory, Lord Jesus. That you would be glorified in all the things that are done in this church, that you would be glorified in all of the earth. Let every person that hears this, Lord, receive the faith that they need, Lord, to receive from you. We pray that your holy angels, Lord, would protect them and guide them, Lord. You know, we pray, Lord, for healing power, Lord, to go out. We pray for the ministry of healing, that it would just touch people's lives, their bodies, their marriages, their finances. Lord, but we especially pray for miracle works of healings, Lord, to go out through this word. And we pray for the equipping of the saints, Lord, the equipping of the saints to do the work that you have called them to do. And the church gives glory unto Jesus, and we say, Amen.
Amen.